So my name is Paul Clavin, and I am in charge to give the course on theory of flames and detonations. You know, just before I start, I would like to give you a general comment following the comment of Professor Lowe. You know, combustion is a fascinating complex phenomenon. The complexity is illustrated by the number, for example, of elementary reactions and the number of intermediate species that are involved in the combustion of any ordinary fuel with air. For example, you have hundreds of elementary reactions and more than 50 intermediate species. But not only the chemical network is complex, but also the transport phenomena of such a multi-component system is also very complex. And so this is for the complexity. Now, why it is so fascinating? It is because mainly a systematic reduction of this complexity can be achieved, especially in combustion, in order that a good description and, let's say, an accurate description and a good understanding of the phenomena is provided by analytical solutions of simple mathematical model. It is very easy to get lost in the details and to miss the target of an overall understanding. That's, you know, the difficult part is to extract from these details the key phenomena that give an overall understanding of the phenomena. And this is the way I am going to present my talk. So I am going to try to emphasize only the simplest phenomena, mechanisms that are explaining the overall phenomena. Now, from a more quantitative point of view, it is useful to add the details. But this has to be done, to my opinion, in the second step, either by numerics, if the system is very complex, or even though in analytical works. But as I say, this has to be done in the second step. And my lecture concerns the first step. So this is what I want to, I would like to tell you before starting my lecture. Okay, the first, no, this is not the right, this is not the right slides. So the right slides is the first slides. Excuse me for that. I'm sorry. Okay, where it is? Here it is. No, not this one. Okay, first lecture. Okay. So, to be successful, such a strategy of reducing the complexity should be developed, like the theoretical analysis, in close connection with experimental laboratory experiments. Without these laboratory experiments, there is no chance to achieve a systematic reduction, which is meaningful, you know. And this is why, for example, in astrophysics, the problems are so difficult, because there is no experiments, laboratory experiments. You know, in combustion, we are lucky from that point of view, because we have very, very good experimental experiments, laboratory experiments, especially, for example, in Princeton, in Professor Lowe laboratory. So so my first lecture will concern only simple things, order of magnitude, and you will see how many important information can be extracted from such a simple analysis. But before, I would like to show you where I am from. You see, I am my university is shared in two cities, Marseille and Aix-en-Provence. Marseille is a very old harbor on the Mediterranean coast. It was built by the Greeks 5 centuries before Christ. And this is a very big harbor and very old. Aix-en-Provence is a more recent city which was built by the Romans only 1 century before Christ, so 4 centuries later, so from Marseille. And the two cities are very different. Yeah, you know, the middle class people in Aix-en-Provence are very different from the melting pot in Marseille. But this, if you have any chance to go to visit this kind of country here, do not hesitate. It's a very wonderful country to visit and to spend some time. Okay. Okay, here are the an overview of the different topics that I would like to discuss with you during this summer school. As you see, there are many, and this is my choice. The choice is to give you, to provide you a wide overview of the phenomena and of the analytical description of this phenomena, okay? So because of the tight schedule, I cannot go through all the technical details in each of this topic. So sometimes I have to skip the technical details, but you have all the necessary information in your notes, and also you have the reference to the original papers in your notes. Concerning these notes, the one you have are different from this one because I correct many different things, but you will have this new version on the internet, okay? Okay, so just a point also. For those who are really, very interested in the theory, they have to redo by themselves the calculation. And there is no other way to really understand things. What I can do in 15 hours is to give you a flavor of the thing. And sometime I will go into details, but I cannot go into all the details in all these topics. Okay. I will start with the overall conversion. You know, since Lavoisier, end of the 18th century, we know that conversion is a result of an exothermal reaction between an oxidant, a fuel, essentially, with an oxidant, the oxygen of air. And the energy which is released by the chemical reaction is coming from the binding energy linking atoms to build molecules. Typically, order of magnitudes of this, excuse me, of this, binding energy is few electron volt per molecule. Let's say usually it is 6, 7. But if you look to one electron volt per molecule, this gives you, for a specific heat of 10 calorie per mole and per Kelvin, give you 2000 K. And the reason why with a higher binding energy you still have this increase in temperature is due to the fact that you have chemical equilibrium and dissociation of the products. I will not go into this detail of the dissociation of a chemical equilibrium and dissociation of the products, because this has to be done. It's not very useful to understand the main thing, okay? So this is the first point. Now, the second characteristic of the overall chemical reaction in combustion is that the reaction, the characteristic reaction time, the inverse of the characteristic reaction time is the reaction rate. This characteristic reaction time is a strongly varying quantity with temperature. For example, below 500 Kelvin, the reaction time is infinite, almost. So the system is frozen out of equilibrium, of chemical equilibrium. It's completely frozen, nothing. But, excuse me. But for 2,500 K, the reaction time is as short as 1 microsecond, even less sometimes. So this strong variation of the reaction rate with the temperature is the key point of combustion. And also it is the reason for the combustion to exist. Because combustion of premixed gas. I have forgot to tell you that I am concerned essentially on premixed gas combustion. All right? So this strong variation is responsible for thermal feedback. When you release heat somewhere, when you heat some locally a reactive mixture, you increase the reaction rate. When you increase the reaction rate, you decrease the reaction. When you increase the reaction rate, you liberate heat, and now this heat is diffused outward, warm up the initially cold side slides of mixture that start to react, and so on and so on and so on. And this is responsible for the fact that in premixed combustion, the reaction proceeds through propagation of waves. This was noticed very early, was understood very early by one of the brightest scientists of the 18th century, Euler, the Swiss mathematician. But one has to wait one century later to have the first experiment. And the first experiment is, schematically represented here. You ignite at one end of a tube, which is initially filled with a premix, and you see the combustion proceeding through the propagation of a wave. All right? And this is essentially due to the fact that you have this feedback between the heat release and the reaction rate that is liberating heat. Okay, half a century later, after Davy, who did the first experiments, two French engineers were looking, doing experiments. They were motivated by explosion in mines, coal mines, as David did. Davy was also motivated by the mine explosion, and they measure propagation velocity of 50 centimeters per second. For ordinary fuel in air, one may reach up to 10 meters per second in very, very energetic mixture as acetylene in oxygen, in pure oxygen. You know, but this is exceptional. Typically, it's the flames, this is called a flame, propagate at a speed slower than 1 meter per second. Typically, 50 centimeters per second. At the same time, two chemists in the same mixture notice a wave that propagates much faster. And not only that, but in this wave, the pressure in the burned gases is much higher than in the fresh mixture. It is the opposite of flame in which it is a little bit smaller, but very, 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 very little bit smaller. So this, at the same time, they discover this, and this is called detonation. And let's say this was in 1984. Let's say 50 years later, it was noticed that these detonations are never planar. There are still cellular. There are always cellular, unsteady, and so on. In the last century, around 1990, John Lee noticed that when the mixture is turbulent, you have a turbulent flow. Now the deflagration, let's say, the generalization of flames called fast deflagration may reach velocity up to 100 meters per second. Okay? And one of the big problems that I will address in this lecture is that possible to transit from a deflagration to a detonation? And this is a very, very important phenomenon for safety reasons, because detonations are very destructive. And most of the accidents you are hearing about, reading newspaper and so on, are never detonation. There are all the time, most of the time, deflagration or fast deflagration. Okay? It is very difficult to ignite a detonation in the air. Okay. Let me start now with dimensional analysis. When you want to address a dimensional analysis, first what you have to identify is what are the dimensional parameters that are involved in your problem. The first dimensional parameter that is important in your problem is the quantity of chemical energy which is released by unit mass of mixture. I will call that in all my lecture QM. This is quantity of energy which is from chemical origin, which is liberated by unit mass of mixture. And as I told you, this gives you a temperature ratio about between 5 and 10. 300 K to 2050, that's at the most. Now, another parameter important is the speed of sound. The speed of sound varies like the square root of temperature. So the speed of sound AB in the burn, B in all my lecture denotes the burned mixture. U denotes the unburned mixture, fresh mixture U, B burned mixture. So the ratio of these two speed of sound is square root of the ratio of the temperature. It's not very high, because even if you take 10, square root is close to 3. So you do not change so much the velocity of the sound. So you have the sound velocity. Now you have the reaction rate. This is an important dimensional parameter. It is the time it takes to liberate heat. And that depends on the temperature, as I told you before. Now, there is another quantity, very important, which is the molecular or thermal diffusion coefficient. But in gas, there are all of the same order of magnitudes. And they will be denoted by this D, and dt is for the thermal diffusivity. So you have all this quantity. And now let's go to a dimensional analysis. How to build a velocity with this quantity? Oh, it's very simple. One is very simple. Because an energy per unit mass is a velocity square, I have just to take the square root of this term. And if I do that, you have the result here. You obtain typically the velocity of a detonation. You see? Very simple. It's not necessary to go into many details to understand that you may have velocity as fast as the sound of the speed of the sound in the burned gas, as of the order of magnitude of that. Very good. Now, if you recall the basic elementary kinetic theory of gases, I will recall that for you later. A diffusion coefficient is as a dimension of I have no habit with this thing. Okay. Now, a diffusion coefficient has a dimension of a velocity square times a time. Okay? Now, if you want to build with this quantity, if you believe that the diffusion is important in the propagation, which is not the case for detonation, but which is the case for, excuse me? Yeah.
And for this slide, it's about 1,000.
Yes, but because this is only order of magnitudes, you know. A factor two does not matter in order of magnitudes.
Yeah, I mean that it is decided by the temperature.
We will see exactly what the formula is. The formula is twice square root of Q. It is twice.
Okay.
You will see. You will see that in the course. I will be back to these details that defining the different regime of detonation, Chapman-Jouguet, overdriven, and so on. You may have very fast detonation if they are overdriven. If they are self-propagating, what is called Chapman-Jouguet detonation, typically it is 2,000 meters per second. But I will go to all this detail later. I just want first to give you, you know, a simple overview, but your question is very interesting because a factor two, yeah, when you do such analysis, does not matter, you know. For dimensional analysis, it's just to have an order of magnitude, you see. For example, the key point is that this is supersonic.
Yeah.
And the other, which is here, how to build a velocity with a diffusion coefficient, and you have to use the time in that case. And the only way is to take square root of diffusion coefficient divided by the time. This is the velocity square, take the square root, and now you obtain typically 1 meter per second, subsonic. So you have these two extreme possibilities that you obtain only on thinking about dimensional analysis. You see, it's a very simple analysis. But I think it is important to realize that a lot of information is obtained just looking in physical terms to this problem.
Okay.
Because physicists enjoy, you know, all the time physicists use dimensional analysis. In fact, before to start any analysis, theoretical analysis, you should start with the dimensional analysis. Should, you should do that, just to be sure that you are on the right track. Okay? Okay, the overall reaction rate. Now I am talking about the overall reaction rate. I am not talking about the detailed mechanism of it. The overall reaction rate can be understood by simple consideration. You know, in gas, reactions are produced by collision between molecules. Okay, most of the collisions are elastic. What does that mean? This means that the kinetic energy entering in the collision is the same as the one getting out. There is no transfer of energy from the internal energy of the molecule to the kinetic energy of the system. This is called an elastic collision. And now, when you want to build a molecule called, for example, which is a product from reactants, because you release heat, the level of energy of because the binding energy is negative, you know, because you have to expand energy to break the bond, so it is a negative quantity. So this is the difference of energy, chemical energy. Between the reactant and the products give you the heat release. But before to do that, you have to break the molecule of reactants. So you have to break break the bond of the reactant. And see, and this, you know, you need energy for that. And you pick this energy from collision. So only the sufficiently energetic collision may produce a combustion a product that is more strongly linked than the reactants. Okay, and now it turns out that the energy, the difference of energy between the two levels, is smaller than the order of magnitude of the energy. So that the barrier that you have to overcome here is very large compared to the energy that you have in the kinetic energy of the molecule. And the ratio is typically 8-10, between 8 and 10. This is typical for any mixture, any combustion product. Okay? Combustion process, excuse me. Now, if you use a kinetic theory of gas, it is very easy to, if you count the number of collisions that have sufficient energy to overcome the barrier, you use the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, which tells you that you have an exponential, you remember your first course in physics, I guess. That you have, this is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution is exponential minus 1/2 of the kinetic energy divided by the temperature. And now, because of this Arrhenius factor, you have, which is very, very small, this exponential is very small, you obtain an exponential term, which is very small, compared to the elastic collision time, which is denoted here by T col, or the collision rate. Elastic collision rate is 1 over T col. So the rate of the reaction is much smaller than the rate of the elastic collision. And this is very, very convenient. Because if it was not the case, you could not have used the macroscopic equation of conservation. You should have to go to the Boltzmann equation. I will explain you that later. This is a key point also in the physics of the combustion problem. that thanks to this large activation energy, we call that this activation energy E. It is the same in the life science. Hold the system out of equilibrium. When you want to build a system, you have to overcome an energy barrier. And this is also the case in life science, for example. But I have no time to discuss this point. And I am not an expert in life science. So it's better I do not talk too much about life science. Okay. Now, another very important outcome of this large activation energy is the difference of reaction rate. If you use this simple formula here, okay, if you use that the collision rate at ordinary condition here, like in this room, in gas, is 10, the collision time is 10 minus 9 minus 9 seconds. Okay? If you use this, and you find out that in the burn, for the burn gas bound to 2000 Kelvin, the reaction rate is the reaction time is 1 microsecond. Reaction rate is the inverse, okay? But if you now use the ratio of temperature of 8, which is typically the case, the reaction rate you obtain at the ordinary condition, the reaction time is larger than the age of the universe. You see, this is very important. You know, this Arrhenius law is very important. It is true that this law does not describe the details of the kinetics of the combustion, of combustion, but it is an essential mechanism to understand most of the phenomena I am going to describe for you. Now we can go a little step further and use the kinetic theory of gases to evaluate it more accurately the velocity of the flame. So okay, excuse me. All right. Now, you know, the diffusion coefficient, typically, the kinetic theory of gas tells you that it is the square of the sound velocity times the elastic collision time. This is the theory. I will recall you that in the next slide, but just I give you this. Now, if you use now this law here, you obtain, using this approximation here, coming from the kinetic theory of gas, that the ratio of the velocity UL, it will be all in all my lecture, will be the velocity of the flame speed, okay? UL, L is for laminar flame speed. A is the sound of speed, the speed of sound. The ratio is square root of this a very small parameter, which is still very small. This shows you immediately that a reaction which is propagated by an equilibrium between diffusion and reaction is necessarily subsonic, strongly subsonic. Okay? So detonation cannot result from such balance. It is another story that I will explain to you. Okay, same thing for the DL will be in all my lecture the flame thickness. The flame thickness, you know, is typically the distance, the thickness between the unburned temperature to the burned temperature. The simple way to obtain that is to take the inflection point here and to take the tangent and to intersect with the two asymptotes. And you have a length, and this is called the detonation, the flame length, flame thickness, excuse me. And this flame thickness, hopefully, now divided by the mean free path is square root of the inverse of it, it's a large number. And this is very convenient because you have many, many elastic collisions in the flame structure so that you may use the equilibrium chemical, the thermodynamic of equilibrium, the law of Maxwell-Boltzmann, for example. Because Maxwell-Boltzmann law works only if you have many collisions. It doesn't work. It is an elastic collision that is building the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Okay? Okay. Just to remind you a few things about the kinetic theory of gas. You have here all the great scientists, Maxwell, Boltzmann, Einstein, who developed this theory. Yeah. The mean free path, as you this is a trajectory, represents a trajectory for a molecule, which is drastically changed by a collision with another molecule, elastic collision here. And between two collisions, each molecule has no interaction, and so it propagates in straight line with a constant velocity. And we call the mean free path is a mean distance between two collisions, it is called L. The velocity of propagation of this is the thermal velocity is simply related to the thermal energy here, which is, and is very order of magnitude the same order of magnitude as the speed of the sound. Okay? And now the time between two collisions called tau call here is simply the ratio of the mean free path divided by the velocity. Okay, now with this in mind, I have mentioned here the random walk. Maybe you remember that from your first lecture in physics, but I will be back to that. You know this molecule. Are doing a random walk. You know? It's random. And this random process was studied essentially by Einstein, but Maxwell did understood all this thing before, but Einstein was the one who developed the diffusion theory based on the random walk. And this is a distribution function of the particle, position of the particle, which start at r equals zero, and this is the evolution in time of the distribution function. It is a Gaussian here, spreading the half width, spread with time like square root of dt. D is a diffusion coefficient. Remember diffusion coefficient, okay? It's dt is a length square. Okay, but keep that in mind. This is written here. So now this is that give you what I said just before concerning the velocity, subsonic velocity of a wave whose propagation is controlled by an equilibrium between diffusion and reaction, which is the case of flames, laminar flames, and this is the flame thickness here, which is much larger than the mean free path. But now, this dimensional analysis, as you just mentioned before, is very limited. For example, if I apply this formula, as they are here, what I get, and I put the right order of magnitude that I know from the physics, I obtain flame between close to 10 meters per second. This is too fast for most of the flame. Most of the flame are 10 times smaller, the speed. And essentially also, the thickness is too small by a factor 10 also. So this means that you cannot trust completely this kind of analysis. But this kind of analysis tells you the essential, the basic mechanisms that are behind the propagation. Okay. Well, okay, for hydrocarbon flames, In this slide here, you have the flame velocity versus the equivalence ratio. The equivalence ratio phi is the ratio of fuel divided by oxidant, such that for phi equal 1, you have a stoichiometry composition. What does that mean? That means when the combustion is complete, you exhaust fuel and oxidant they are both completely consumed, both of them, at stoichiometry. In theory, because equilibrium is going to change a little bit this thing, but wholly speaking, it is right. For phi larger than 1, you have an excess of fuel, and for phi smaller than 1, you have an excess of oxygen. All right? And the velocity depends, when you are in air here, the quantity of fuel that you put in this mixture, air is fixed, and you see that you go down here up to something like 8 centimeters per second on both sides, rich or lean. But you cannot go below. Why? Do you know why? Excuse me?
It's no longer flammable.
Yes, exactly. But what does that mean, it is no longer flammable? I will explain you that in detail, but you're right. Exactly, you're right. It is a limit of flammability here, which means that you cannot propagate a flame in such beyond such composition. And the reason is that the temperature is too low, and there is a kinetic consideration that tells you that the temperature should be across something like 1,000 K. If the energy that is in the chemical energy that you have in this mixture is not sufficient to be above this, what I will call later on the crossover temperature, which is a kinetic point of view, which is a kinetic, chemical kinetics consideration, there is no reaction. So now here you have a profile of flame which is computed by different by a code, numerical code, and which is also verified by experiments for lean methane flame close to the flammability limit. And you notice that the thickness here, the characteristic length to consume the methane, for example, here, is 1 millimeter. It's much larger than what tells you the dimensional analysis. But the reason for that here is written here, is that the flame thickness behaves like the inverse of the flame velocity. If you decrease the flame velocity, you increase the flame thickness. So, about the maximum velocity at the, around the equivalence ratio, the stoichiometric mixture, excuse me, around the stoichiometric mixture here, you have a thickness which is 1/10 millimeter, typically. But if you decrease by a factor 5 or factor 10 the velocity, then you increase the thickness. This is why the experimentalists used to work with slow flame or also low pressure. But it's, I did not mention here the pressure because it is, I don't want to go into the detail for the moment. I have just here mentioned Semenov, who was the first who developed the chain branching reaction, but not for combustion, for atomic bomb, for atomic reaction, okay, but the ideas come from him. Now, now we will, I will present to you the detailed analysis of the planar flame solution to begin with. But I have to tell to you first that, that this solution is very difficult to observe. It does not exist, except in some particular case when you use a plug burner or a very slowly propagating flame. I will explain you why propagating downward. Usually, this solution is unstable. What does that mean? This means it is like this ball on a ramp. A ramp, you say? How do you say that? This ramp? Ramp? In a ramp? Ramp, okay. This ball here, you know, this is an equilibrium position, okay? The least fluctuation destroys the equilibrium. This is exactly what happened for the planar flame solution. It does not. It is unstable. Okay, there are two reasons for the instability of flame. One important reason, and the first one, is the difference of density. Why there is a difference of density? Because pressure is almost constant. It's very, very, very few. So in a gas, density time temperature is almost constant in a flame. So if you increase the temperature, you decrease the density. Now, if you decrease the density, as I will explain to you, you induce the velocity. If you assume that the flame is infinitely thin, and you consider the flame as a hydrodynamical discontinuity between two flows, one flow and a less dense, a dense flow here and a light flow on the other side, the velocity, the streamlines are deflected. And I will explain you that in detail. Maybe you know that. I don't know. Maybe some of you know already all these things. But OK, we will refresh our mind with this, OK? And this is interesting to, this is going to produce an instability. And this is the case, for example, for this lean propane air flame that you see here. And you see, it's not planar. It propagates downward in a quiet medium. There is no turbulence, see? Okay? It's a laminar propagation. It's not planar. And you notice that there are cusps here, what we call cusps. Maybe in mathematics, we should call that corner better than cusp, because cusps is when the slope is vertical. Okay, the slope is infinite. But and this is easily explained, you know, by the a very old construction in optics called the Huygens construction. Huygens construction. When you propagate in optic, it is a phase surface. Here it is a flame front. If you propagate that with this curve, initially curved smooth front with a constant normal velocity, you end up here with singularity. You know, because you all these points are here collapse on one point. And you are building a corner. And this corner is, this is a two-dimensional picture, but this is a three-dimensional. All right. So, and this also explains how you saturate you know, this is going to decrease the surface area. And this is going, this nonlinear mechanism, it is a nonlinear mechanism that is very important to saturate the linear instability. Because when you are linear, you escape from the initial steady state, but where are you going? Okay? And the linear analysis cannot tell you where you are going. You have to go to a nonlinear analysis. And this is a very important nonlinear phenomena. Very simple. Huygens construction. All right? Now there is another different instability, quite different. This one is essentially due It essentially results from a modification of the inner structure of the flame. I will discuss that later in details. And this phenomena, this second instability, is called diffusional thermal instability. The first one is called hydrodynamic instability. For this first one, you can consider the flame as a hydrodynamical discontinuity. In the diffusion thermal instability, you have to investigate the inner structure of the wrinkled flame. And you see the result. This was a lean propane flame. This is a rich propane flame, which is thermal, as I will explain to you. It is diffusional thermal unstable. And you see, you have much smaller cells on the big cells due to hydrodynamics here. And also the color is different. And the color is, I am not a chemist, so I don't want to tell you, but if I remember well, this color is coming from CH, the radiation of CH. And you are building CH in the burned gases if you are rich. And this is why the color is so different. And the blue, I don't remember the blue, what is coming. I don't know. I don't remember. Now, let me check how long it takes. You have 5 minutes more. And now there are other kinds of instability called system instability for flame or combustion in a cavity or a flame propagating in a tube. The coupling of the flame, for a reason I am going to explain to you in details along this course, this coupling with acoustic waves become unstable. But you know, it is not intrinsic to the flame itself. It is an interaction between the flame propagating, which is a local quantity, to a global quantity, which is the acoustic wave, because acoustic is global. It is all over the cavity, you know, acoustic is not localized. And this is called a thermoacoustic instability. It was understood, the basics, a long time ago by Lord Rayleigh, you know, who was a bright scientist, a British scientist, English scientist, by the way. And this instability is a nightmare of the engineer who have in charge the conception of combustion chamber, rocket engine, especially liquid rocket engine, very strongly unstable. Maybe you remember some disaster when the Americans send people in the moon. And they got a terrible instability, not with the people inside, but on the bench when they try. And so this delay the program for more than 2 or 3 years. Also, it is very interesting to notice that the first rocket engine, you know, the first rocket engine was a V2. Bombing England, see? And the main difficulty they had, it was hydrogen, oxygen rockets. It is incredible when you look. There is a museum in French where you have the first V2, and you compare with the last rocket engine of Ariane Space, for example. It's incredible how close it is. You know, the conception is very close. No, the details are quite different. You have all the electronics and so on. And it's quite different. But at that time, the main difficulty German people sending this rocket was to be safe with the rocket instability. And I was an expert in France for the Ariane space. And I spent many of my time trying to understand why there was a crash, for example. And I can tell you that the answer is not coming from me. They are coming from the engineer. Who look, you know, small details change everything. So it's a very difficult problem to get rid of this thermoacoustic instability. You have that also now in gas turbines. Gas turbines are typically, gas turbines, huh? So these usual things, are terribly, can be terribly unstable by thermoacoustic instability. So I will, in my lecture, I'll give you some physical explanation of that. And also I want, yes, I have some time, to show you now an experiment. Laboratory experiment in Marseille by Jeff Sirby, and using a cross-section of the frame due to a technique due to Louis Boyer, Professor Louis Boyer. It's all technique already, but you will see. Let me show you. So the experiment is a vertical flame, a vertical tube, a flame propagating downward in a vertical tube. Very simple experiment. Cannot imagine a much simpler experiment than that, okay? I will see. And we use two, here I will show you two experiments for two different lean methane flame, two equivalence ratios which are very close. Not much difference, okay? Now listen, okay, I have to put the let me increase to maximum the sound. And now, just you have to listen. First to listen, and then you will see a movie. Okay. First experiment. Ah, the flame become planar, and nothing strange. Look the second one. Listen. You see? Small difference. Whew. Drastic effect. This is why. Now, okay, now look to a cross section of the flame. First time the flame initially was curved and become planar. Okay? And this I will explain to you also why it becomes planar. It's very interesting. And then a secondary instability develops. You see? And this is so strong that the flame is going to be blow up before reaching the end of the tube. See, extinguish. You see? Uh-huh. This is interesting science, more than the theory, you know? Just the experiment. I am not an experimentalist, but I am fascinated by it. I did theory because I was working all my life close to experimentalists, because they are dealing with the real world, you know. I am playing with game, with mathematics and so on, but okay. You know, I am all the time surprised by this very feeling. It's Galileo, I think, the first one who says that. You know, it is surprising that the world around us can be understood by human mind using mathematics. How it is like that? This is a very, very deep question, I can tell you. And Einstein also did, you know, express the same feeling. How is it possible that the nature can be is described in terms of, because Galileo said that the nature is a book which is written in a language. This language is mathematics. Why it is like that, I don't know. and he didn't know. okay, just to finish, and we are going to have a break of 10 minutes. Just to show you now other experiments, showing to you the, and I try to motivate your attention, you know, why to do analysis, okay? There on the left, you have a flame propagating upwards. It looks like a bubble. You know, a bubble rising of air, rising in a tube filled water with water is similar to that. Okay. So now if I do the same, I take the same mixture, but now propagating downward, not upward. I ignite on the top, okay? And I use a very low flame. This flame is 8 cm/s. It's near extinction. Because I am around the flammability just before, 8-9 cm/s. Quite plain. So you see the effect of the gravity here? This is because of the difference of density. Now, if I just increase a little bit the velocity of this flame propagating downward, you see immediately on the flame cellular structure that appear. Very regular to begin with. Very regular structure. So we spend, I spend many time in my life to describe these things. Another spectacular effect is you take a Bunsen burner. You understand what is a Bunsen burner? It's not necessary I describe that. This is a rich flame. So you have, you see, this is a premixed, the cone of the premixed flame, and you have the diffusion flame outside. But this diffusion flame is not useful. What is important here is what I, now, is a premixed, the premixed cone, okay? Now, you take this flame, you put a loudspeaker in the feeding tube, okay? And you send acoustic wave, longitudinal acoustic wave, and you how you say, adjust the frequency. Look what happened. The flame changed completely shape. You know, this flame, which was initially conic, is now almost hemispherical, not hemispherical. In fact, it turns out that this here is the equipotential surface in the absence of flame. This is purely acoustic, the equipotential acoustic. Turns out that the flame surface goes to an equipotential, and it goes to the equipotential such that the surface area is the same as this one. Okay, it's time now to have a break of, let's say, 10-minute breaks, okay?